Walt Disney's history, we find these key moments where if the stars hadn't aligned and everything hadn't come together, there would be no Disney. And really what saved him is that cute little elephant with those big flappy ears that can fly.
At the time that Dumbo was made, the Disney studio was in financial trouble. Amazingly enough, Pinocchio and Fantasia did not succeed at the box office when they were first released.
They had to do a shorter, smaller, I guess smarter picture, and that was Dumbo.
The economy of storytelling in that film is just so well done. I mean, it's a film that anybody studying animation storytelling should look at. I think even live-action filmmaking.
Everybody working on it was such a great pro, and by being that strong in all of their choices, in their layout choices, in their design choices, in their animation choices, it makes what you could conceive as a very small film very, very powerful.
They weren't armed like the crew of Pinocchio with the budget. They had a job to do. They had to get this out. The movie is sort of the metaphor for that attitude, and it's sort of perfectly fitting for what the movie was and how it was made.
Disney's golden age, in the late 30s, early 1940s, the five films that were produced then, Snow White, Pinocchio, Fantasia, Dumbo, and Bambi, they were all very different from one another, and they all had great merit as particular stories.
I think with those five movies, they were inventing the form of feature animation and kind of the form that would carry on through the rest of the century. People studying animation would definitely look to as the pinnacle of what animation could be and maybe even the possibilities that animation could have.
It was monumental. I mean, Snow White, the first full-length animated feature done at Disney, it speaks for itself. I always look at like the jumps in film history, and if you look at Steamboat Willie, you know, 28, to Snow White, 37, think of how short of amount of time that is, and look at the difference of those films. To me, it represents the greatest leap in cinema history, and it blows my mind the light year that they went in just, you know, that decade.
In Pinocchio, it is about the sheer level of perfection and craftsmanship. There is so much going on in the perfection of the lighting, the drawing on the characters, the beautiful realization of lots and lots of detail, but without actually minimizing the strength of the characters and the strength of the story.
And then you see Fantasia, and Fantasia is like truly taking animation to another dimension where it's really trying to go, this is fine art. We're really pushing the boundaries here. We're really gonna see where it breaks. And that Bambi, they're trying to explore, you know, real movement. Can we capture how animals will move? You know, can we really sell this in animation? Each one seems like they were trying to go, all right, now where can we take the animation medium? And then there's Dumbo.
There are great things in all the classic Disney movies, you know, things to aspire to, things that we feel they'll never be done any better than this. And Dumbo is one of those films that might even be a notch above those. And I think it's largely because, without doubt, people feel it is the most emotional film that the studio ever made. It is the one that really grabs your heart.
I think Dumbo is a perfect movie. It's just as seamless in terms of the way the story is told, but it also has great character animation. And I think ultimately it has a real emotional punch and a resonance that stays with you, stays with audiences.
The story of the misfit who gets kicked around and not treated well, everybody identifies with that. That's the reason that this film, above the others, really is very, very special, because it connects with people here.
The book was written in 1938 by Helen Aberson and Harold Pearl. It was the only published children's book that the couple ever did. They sold the story to a company called Rollerbook, where the book would be on a scroll and you'd read through it. I don't think there are any copies of it that exist anymore. There was about 16 illustrations that were done by a local Syracuse artist, and those still exist. They're up in the collection up in Syracuse. So Disney locked up the rights and then gave the project to two of his top writers, and that was Joe Grant and Dick Humor.
Joe Grant was one of the few people that Walt really trusted with a story.
After Walt, he was probably one of the most influential figures in the studio because of the impact he would have both on the story and on the design of the characters.
He had done caricatures for the LA Record in the 1920s, was discovered there by Disney, brought into the studio in 1933 to work on a short called Mickey's Gala Premiere, which was about Mickey having a Hollywood premiere and all the Hollywood stars come. Joe Grant did all the caricatures for that. Walt Disney recognized his brilliance as a creator, and so he brought him in to design characters for the Silly Symphonies and other Mickey Mouse shorts.
So Walt had Joe set up what they called the character model department to help set the looks of the characters. So early model sheets for Snow White and Pinocchio would very often have an OK JG, OK Joe Grant. But actually, it developed more into a think tank in terms of developing the personalities of the characters, as well as the kinds of stories that could be told in animation.
It was where a lot of the ideas for future films came from, including things like Lady and the Tramp, etc., etc.
And then he left the studio at the end of the 40s and came back at a studio in the 90s. And his influence in the 90s was very strong. I mean, he's the one who gave the idea for some of the characters in Pocahontas. He gave a lot of story ideas and gag ideas for quite a few of the movies of the new golden age of Disney animation.
Joe lived to be almost 100 years old. He was 96 when he died. And if you think about it, there are very few people who've lived almost the entire 20th century. Joe was one of them.
He died the day after he had been to work, and he loved everything he did. He loved working on Lion King, Beauty and the Beast, Pocahontas. It never stopped.
Dick Humor was a very early veteran animator in New York, and he worked in one of the first animation studios, the Raoul Barre studio up in the Bronx. And eventually he went out to California and was sought after by Walt Disney because he was considered one of the finest animators on the East Coast. He eventually went with Disney, worked on a whole number of Silly Symphonies, and then was paired with Joe Grant on Fantasia.
My father was probably put on Fantasia because of his interest in classical music. In fact, my father was sometimes introduced by Walt as, "Meet Dick Humor. He goes to operas."
They both came from New York, and so they had a lot in common. And I think their personalities were quite a bit alike, too. They could depend on each other. One would shoot an idea, and the other would shoot back. And that's how this all was done.
In January of 1940, Walt asked Joe Grant and Dick Humor to start developing this story of this little elephant with the big ears.
The story was very sketchy in the original version. And what they did was they made a whole bunch of additions and changes to it. It was a little red robin that was the friend of Dumbo in the original story. And they changed that into a mouse, which is a great idea because elephants are supposed to be afraid of mice. So that was one addition they did. They brought in immediately in their writing the pink elephants on parade sequence and the stork sequence. Those were two that they figured out right away.
When they were working on the story, Joe Grant and Dick Humor would not give a completed treatment to Walt. What they would do is give him one chapter at a time to tease him.
I don't think any other movie was pitched to Walt in quite the same way. And they wrote it sort of with a hint of cliffhanger very often.
So they would put little drawings on the side of the pages. There was one that said, had a big teardrop on it, said, "Don't read any further, dear reader, if you are fearful that this is going to upset you, because I can tell you things are going to get a lot worse from here on." So they intrigued Walt Disney. He'd come in and he'd say, "Gee, this is great stuff. We got to, you know, what happens next?"
Within a month, Walt looked at what they had done and knew that this was a film he wanted to take.
So within about 6 months after that, it was in storyboard stage. Then it went into animation, I think, in the fall of 1940. And it was completed pretty much before the Disney strike, which was in May of 1941.
Yeah, the strike was really brewing during the latter production of Dumbo, especially animation. And those were the guys that were really arguing on going out on strike and whether the union was a company union and whatnot. Bill Tytla was key on Dumbo. Fortunately, you know, he finished his sequences a week or so before the strike went out.
And also, at the time that Dumbo was made, the United States was contemplating going to war. The war had been raging in Europe since 1939 and had cut off about three quarters of their overseas income. In those days, there was no Disneyland. There wasn't a lot of ancillary merchandise that they could exploit. And so they lived and died, as it were, by their films. They had to succeed. Otherwise, there wouldn't be a Disney studio.
By Pinocchio, there was very little foreign revenues. In fact, it was only dubbed into two languages, Spanish and Portuguese. After Snow White, which made an enormous amount of money, everything started to lose money. Fantasia lost money.
The studio was facing some really hard financial times, and they really had to try and reduce budgets without impacting the quality of the movie.
For Snow White, they developed scenes and sequences for the dwarf characters, such as a sequence where they built a bed for Snow White, or a sequence where they came down to eat the soup that she had made. And Walt pulled those sequences out. There was a lot of time and expense made in creating those sequences. On Dumbo, the story was so solid. They knew exactly how they were going to tell the story. They didn't spend their time developing sequences that would end up being thrown out.
They also had to find some new technical tricks to save money. For example, some of the backgrounds that you find in the story sketches, photostats of those were used as backgrounds. And that really had never been done before.
The backgrounds were done in very beautiful but simple watercolors. Watercolor is an interesting medium because once you lay down the color on your paper, you can't really go back and tweak it and paint over it the way that you could with oils or other medium.
On the screen, the quality was still the same, was still the Disney quality of animation and of backgrounds and so on.
Another way that they were able to save money was by using less elaborate special effects. The effects didn't play a role in the film the way that they did in Pinocchio and Bambi.
Bambi took 9 years to make. Very cumbersome production, very work intensive. The animal anatomy, I mean, the production value was a whole other ballgame. Whereas Dumbo was a much simpler story, and the animation is brilliant, but it's a different type, a type that's more caricature than reality based.
Dumbo, in a sense, was much more like the silly symphonies in the short cartoons. It was kind of a long, silly symphony. And so many of the artists working on Dumbo were really the artists that grew out of those short cartoons.
I asked Joe Grant one time, what is it that makes Dumbo great? And his answer was, well, we had all the top guys. So anybody who knows the Nine Old Men is thinking, oh, well, gee, but all of them were over there working on Bambi. And yet, on Dumbo, you had all these great people who taught that lot that was making Bambi.
In a way, Dumbo is kind of a changeover. The old guard, Art Babbitt, Vladimir Tytlow, some of the others who were involved with the strike, left the studio after that. So a certain kind of animator left, and then people who became what were known as the Nine Old Men really took over after that.
So on Dumbo, it was really the original old guard, the guys who established the Disney style, who were really showing what they had. And they were such great pros at it, and they had so much fun on it. You also had Ward Kimball, who kind of straddled both, but he would have been a bad fit on Bambi, given that his proclivity was for cartoony things. So when Joe says, we had the top guys, I believe him.
Yeah, there's a certain vitality and spirit to the animation, I think. It's interesting that so many of the top animators on Dumbo, many of them were from New York.
There's a sort of New York sensibility in a way to the storytelling and the visualization of Dumbo. You think about a lot of those children's books that came out of New York publishing, and a lot of these animators that worked on Dumbo came out of New York animation.
Vladimir Tytlow started in New York. Art Babbitt started in New York. Hicks Loki was in New York. They all kind of worked in a studio atmosphere where you tried things, you know, and if it didn't work, you tried it over again. I think they all had this kind of energy to the animation that some of the animators who later trained at Disney had more refinement. Their stuff was still great as well, but it's a different kind of animation.
From the old guard, Bill Tytlow is definitely my favorite. When you look at what he had done in the past, he did Chernabog in Fantasia. He did Stromboli in Pinocchio.
Quiet before I knock you silly.
So very powerful characters, very strong characters. And then in Dumbo, he does that small, cute, wonderful elephant that's so sweet and then completely believable and as emotional as the characters he had done in the past. And he says that he was inspired for Dumbo by his son Peter, who was 2 years old at the time.
Art Babbitt was Bill Tytler's best friend. And Babbitt was a fine, superb animator himself, very analytical. He was one of the first to take home movies of real people so that he could study it on his own. He did Stork in Dumbo. It's a wonderful, amusing caricature of the actor who did the voice, Sterling Holloway.
Which one of you ladies is expecting? I'll watch it.
Babbitt was terrific in terms of timing. One of his great pieces of animation is only a minute long, but it's the dancing mushrooms in Fantasia.
Here, take a trunk full.
Freddie Moore, who's one of my favorite animators of all time, did most of Timothy Mouse. And so he's done, you know, Timothy wobbling and losing his balance and going, "Hiya, George!" and all that stuff. He knows whereof he speaks. And it's marvelous, beautiful animation. It's also very sympathetic animation.
You ought to be ashamed of yourselves, picking on a poor little orphan like him.
When he's admonishing the crows for making fun of Dumbo, he's doing all that stuff where Timothy is saying, "Go on, laugh at him.
Kick him now that he's down. Go on!"
And that's very emotional stuff, too.
We don't care. Come on, Dumbo.
Ward Kimball animated primarily the crows who make fun of Dumbo and then really become his mentors on how to fly.
Use the magic feather. Catch y'all?
And it is marvelous, kinetic animation. Very, very exhilarating to watch. Very loose, kind of great choreography.
As they did with many of the films, they used live action as a reference. For Snow White, they had March Champion going through motions, and then they would use that as a model. For the crow sequence in Dumbo, they used a song and dance team, the Jackson Brothers, who, like the Nicholas Brothers, had performed in movies. They came from vaudeville, and they came up with a lot of routines that then Ward Kimball went and plussed in the animation. Maybe the Jacksons had something where they linked arms and they went, you know, back and forth in the same sort of syncopation. But Ward Kimball would make it so it looked like the two crows were one crow and they were working on maybe three legs or something like that. He would just push it a little bit further in the animation.
Well, look at here, look at here. My.
The crows come in for a certain amount of controversy these days, but all the horseplay between the crows, which Ward animates so well, all that back chat and back and forth that they do.
What's cooking around here? What's the good news? What's frying, boy?
That is absolutely accurate to the kind of back chat you would hear from the band on a Cab Calloway record or on a Louis Armstrong record. It's the kind of thing where that kind of back and forth dialogue was totally faithful to that spirit. And I feel like the portrayal of those characters is faithful to that exuberance as well.
They are, I would say, the most important characters next to the two leads in the film. They're like surrogate fathers, as Timothy Mouse is to Dumbo. They're the ones who are the most intelligent, the happiest, the freest-spirited characters in the whole film, and the warmest. They're the ones who give Dumbo hope.
You boys is okay!
As an alienated group themselves, they sympathize with his plight, being ostracized because of his physical being.
They made him a clown!
So it's kind of a brilliant juxtaposition there.
Dumbo's got great, cartoony, streamlined characters, very, very simple design. By and large, the film's unabashedly a cartoon and proud of it. And I think that's what makes it great.
Dumbo is very eclectic in terms of its look. First of all, they probably thought circus poster, you know? There's a brightness to it. There's a boldness to the graphics. It starts right at the beginning, in which the titles are like circus posters. You might also see elements of some regionalist painters in there. They're like Grant Wood's Rolling Hills, the countryside that the little train goes through. All of these influences were there, and one of the strangest ones is surrealism. Where surrealism was on the minds of America at that time in the late 1930s. There had been exhibits at the Museum of Modern Art, and Dali was certainly promoting himself as a personality as much as a painter. So I think that whole Pink Elephants thing definitely has that kind of influence.
pink elephants on parade, you're really talking about some very interesting shape and color transitions from one idea to the next. One character can form a shape, and then that dissolves in a very surrealistic way to a different shape.
In 1946, Walt Disney did team up with Salvador Dali, and they decided to do something called Destino. Salvador Dali was attracted to it because of the title. Mysterious Destino, destiny, you know.
The unfinished film that Walt had begun with Salvador Dali, Destino, was eventually finished by Roy Disney, Walt's nephew, just a few years ago.
I think Walt was encouraged to do Destino because of the success of Pink Elephants on Parade. It was a parody of surrealism, but still, it proved that it could be effective.
Walt Disney did always try to experiment on one side to connect with his audience, and what he would put on screen would be what really connected to his audience. And then you see that he would help his artists actually find new ways to do things.
There was this richness of all the arts of the world were brought into the Disney studio so that Disney could help improve not only himself, but all the animators.
You know, it was on Fantasia, I believe, that Joe Grant brought in some Heinrich Kley drawings to show Walt and say, maybe we can make something out of it. And Heinrich Kley's fanciful animals, who had human emotions and did human things, morphed into the Dance of the Hours sequence. And I dare say Heinrich Kley was probably an influence on the way they portrayed the elephants in Dumbo.
Stravinsky had come through the studio and other daring artists.
He brought Frank Lloyd Wright also around that same time to the studio to make a conference to the artists. You can definitely see the influence of T.S. Sullivan on many of the Disney artists. His whimsy style is very, very visible in really all of the movies, including Dumbo. He brought Aldous Huxley to work on other features at the studio. And so literary influences, architectural influences, design influences, he just wanted his artists to absorb everything and to enrich themselves as much as possible.
And there were also cinematic influences, such as German Expressionism. They looked at films from the 1920s, at Cabinet of Dr. Caligari, and Nosferatu. And there's a sequence in Dumbo in which Timothy Mouse starts to approach the ear of the ringmaster, and the shadow forms. And I swear it's from Nosferatu, the vampire shadow coming over him. So using shadows to create mood or to enhance the eerie feeling of a scene, these were things that they studied. And it works. They found the right place to use the right influences.
Dumbo is a mastery of visualization, using symbolism and using ideas that come across to the audience subliminally.
Sometimes in animation lectures, when I'm talking about layout and storytelling and how that can help people's responses, I point out a sequence. Dumbo has been separated from his mother, and she's in the cage, swaying back and forth, and she's got the shadows of the prison bars on her as stripes. You dissolve to Dumbo, and he's swaying back and forth sadly in front of the circus tent, which has stripes. And you immediately, subliminally connect the two. It's something that's very, very sophisticated filmmaking that doesn't come out and grab you and say, here, look at this symbolism. But it's something that they are doing very, very consciously.
The music in Dumbo is really something special. The musical score received an Academy Award, and Baby Mine got a nomination for the best song. The trio that came together to do the songs and the score were some Disney veterans that had wonderful careers. The two that wrote the music were Oliver Wallace and Frank Churchill. And the lyricist was Ned Washington. And Ned was an unbelievable wordsmith. The lyrics in the Dumbo songs are some of the most creative, most fun, exciting, great use of the English language.
I seen the front porch swing, heard a diamond ring. I seen a polka dot railroad tie, but I be done seen about everything when I see a elephant fly.
Walt's use of music in his films is legendary, you know, and he always wanted the songs to advance the plot. So when Snow White sings, "Someday My Prince Will Come," you'll know, oh, that's what she really yearns for. But in a film like Dumbo, the music is less about advancing the plot than a comment on it. It's the kind of thing where you are seeing the crows make fun of Dumbo and say, when I see an elephant fly, they're just continuing their riff and it goes into music.
Did you ever see an elephant fly?
I seen a dragon fly.
I seen a house fly.
See, I seen all that too. I seen a peanut stand. Heard a rubber band.
It has that kind of seamless quality. Even the Baby Mind song is something that you feel it's coming through the mind of the mother. You don't see lip sync or anything like that, but it's her singing as she's cradling her baby.
Baby of mine.
When you see the pink elephants on parade sequence, the song isn't telling you anything about story.
On their head, clippity-coppity.
Neither is the sequence, really, but it's there as a great kind of offbeat, bizarro, experimental color piece that is unique amongst Disney features.
Just as the music of Dumbo hit a perfect note, the film itself hit a perfect note with audiences. It was a tremendous success. Many, many people came to see it again and again. Fortunately, it was a financial success at a time that Walt really needed it.
And actually, when the movie is released, all of the reviews say, whoa, Walt is back to basics.
When it was released, America is on the brink of war. I think it really gave America a place to escape.
Time magazine, several months after the release of the film, planned to put Dumbo on the cover, talking about the success of this little elephant who could. Unfortunately, Pearl Harbor intervened.
So the issue that appeared shortly thereafter removed Dumbo, and instead we see a picture of Admiral Yamamoto on the cover.
All the years that have passed from when Dumbo came out to now, with all the computer science of the world, not a day goes by that we don't talk about Dumbo, and I think that is so telling and how powerful it is of a film.
They weren't making any pretensions about making great art, and by doing that, they made great art, and that's pretty amazing.
There's a lot of people that say Dumbo's the greatest animated feature ever made. When you think about that, people in the know that have seen all the animation, that know what's going on, that proclaim Dumbo to be the best film ever as an animated film. So there's something really special about the film.
It represents a perfect balance of emotion, humor, whimsy, all the things that animation can do so well. Dumbo is like this perfect recipe.
The simplicity of Dumbo and the joy in making a film that you knew where you were going from beginning to end was something that Walt never had really again. And that his artists never experienced again. After Dumbo, everything really did get more complicated. Walt was more distanced from his artists. The Disney studio was a very different place after Dumbo. And in a sense, Dumbo and its light and joyfulness represents perhaps the apex and the end of that sort of golden age at the Disney studio.